Let me tell you, for you to get this and just understand why this message is important to you. I do feel in a lot of ways that you are my family. And I care about all of you all. And I feel like sometimes when you don't get blessed in the way I want you to get blessed, I think I'm principally the leader and I'm responsible. I have been hurt over the past 30 days to lose two people that I feel like I should not have lost. I know God, He has His way. But I lost two sisters. I don't want to lose nobody else. I've been praying for your strength to equal your days. And I admitted on Wednesday night that I came up short. Perhaps I should have added to it. Because when my sisters, as young as they are, in their 50s, depart from here, I know they're going to be with the Lord. But I didn't want them going nowhere. I don't want none of y'all going nowhere. I want you to stay here. And I know you got challenges in life and things, and I know you may think that's so bold of me to say this, but I'm taking some authority over your lives when I'm speaking, when I give you God's word. I'm taking some authority. I don't want none of y'all to prematurely leave here. Amen. I believe in the power of God to keep all of us so that our strength can equal our days. There's nothing wrong with that. That's a biblical thing. May your strength equal your days. I recognize that maybe I came up short when I should have said, because see, for each one of those two sisters, that's Natalie and Inger, for each one of those two sisters, their strength equaled their days. And they were here one day and then they were gone. And so that's the keeping of what it was. So therefore, I've realized what I got to do is add to it that you're going to live long and prosper. I don't want to lose anybody. Now, I know that's bold. You said it there. You talk about like you got authority over this. I believe that God has given all of us certain authorities in the earth, and maybe I'm reaching for mine, but it's worth me reaching to hold on to every one of y'all that I can. And who knows? God might hear my prayer and God might sustain what I'm asking for, that your strength equal your days and you live long and you prosper in the life that you live. That's what I want for you. I was out in the hall talking just a minute ago, and when I made a comment to Brother Ed Harris, he made mention, he said, you know, and my sister, she lost her car. She totaled her car the other day and she could have lost her life. That's Sister Charlene, Minister Charlene. Amen. And I realized, yeah, that's true. That could have happened, but God kept her. Amen. And she got out of a car that was totaled. Said she went up, she was going up the expressway, going over to the Homewood. And she lost control of the car, and the car went over into the other lane. You know that lane coming down? And she went and hit the wall on the other side. There were no cars coming down that way, because if a car come, that would have been a direct. But she hit a wall and totaled the car. She got out the car, and they said she was standing up just looking at the car like, what had happened? Angels were there for her. I believe that we have angels that are at our disposal, and I want to call on those angels to be for each and every one of you all. I am fighting a war. I'm fighting a war against the enemy, against Satan, wherever he is. And I believe that we have authority. I believe that we have power. And I believe we have to walk in that authority and we have to take command. Amen. God gave us the ability to have dominion over this earth. Now, maybe I don't think like everybody else, but I never have and I don't care. I know what the word said and I'm standing on the word. I take dominion on this earth. Because that's what God's plan was. He said, be fruitful and multiply. He said, replenish the earth. Subdue and take dominion. That's part of our divine potential. And one of the things, I'm not going to just let death come up in here and take one or two of y'all at his pick and choose. Not up in my congregation. I have been hurt by what has happened. And I'm not going to sit down and let him do what he wants to do. I know it's God's will. God lets it go. But I'm going to hold on like Hezekiah to every one of y'all. And I want you to understand that. You're my family. You are my family. And I love every one of you all. And when I lose, like Natalie and Inga, I felt that hurt. I mean, I felt the hurt through each situation. But this one, these two young girls ain't supposed to be gone nowhere. Amen. And their strength equal their days. And that's why I realized I messed up. It's going to be from this point on. May your strength equal your days. And a simple phrase, you live long and you prosper. I'm fighting that. I took the one Sunday off because I needed some time here. And I have a message I'm going to give to you today because it's going to strengthen you. Said your strength equal your days. Now, God has given me a word to tell you how I'm going to latch this thing up and I'm going to hold on to every one of y'all just as long as I can. And I want you to look at 2 Chronicles 16 and 9. And I want you to see something. I'm fighting a war here. I'm not fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and authorities and spiritual wickedness in high places. But the scripture says right here that the eyes of the Lord reigns throughout the earth to strengthen. Look at those words. I said, may your strength equal your days. And I want you to know something. Unless the Lord builds the house, they that labor in vain. You can do everything you want to do to strengthen your own life. But unless God does it, you're not going to stand. So I have a scripture that God gave me to give to you, that his eyes are looking all through over the earth to strengthen, to find those he can strengthen. And the strengthen is to strengthen you so that your strength will equal your days. But notice the condition upon which he says this. So that your days might be long on this, he says, to those whose hearts are fully committed. If I want you to have long days and I want you to be strengthened all those days, see, may your strength equal your days can mean that your strength might go out and it might go out early and God pulls you out. But if God is strengthening you each and every day, if he strengthens you, though you might be wasting away on the outside, but he's strengthening you, you will live long. Hallelujah. Because unless God withdraw his hand, you know, you'll continue to live. He keeps his hand on you and you continue to live. You continue to be blessed. Yes, sir. And my desire is that you are blessed all the days of your life. But notice the commitment that God says, those who are fully committed to him. Notice the condition. In order for you to be blessed, in order for you to have long life, he said, my words are health. It's medicine to all those that find them. And I have found something for my congregation. For you to understand, when I tell you, may your strength equal your days, God says, be fully committed to me, and I will strengthen you all the days of your life. Do you see what I'm saying to you? Yes, I'm not playing. I know I'm at war against an enemy whose only desire is to handicap you, is to rob you, is to kill you. That enemy, Satan, is out to destroy you. Not with my house. Not with my house.
Yes, sir.
And he says to those whose hearts, see the word hearts. Say the word hearts.
Hearts.
Whose hearts are fully committed. Say hearts fully committed.
Hearts fully committed.
Now, if your heart is fully committed, now you read that and tell me, if your heart is fully committed to God, what is God committed to do for you? You need to say that, get that in your head, because you got to have this. You got to believe God's going to honor your faith. If my heart is fully committed to the Lord, my God will what? You need to get that in your mind. If my heart is fully committed to the Lord, my God will
strengthen me.
And I can be confident that all the days of my life, my strength will be with me until the very last day when God says, time to come home. You see the thing, like, it was Caleb. He was at his age, he said he was at 85, and he said, I'm just like a young man, just like I was when I was 35. My strength has not wasted away from me. And like it was with Moses, I believe if God did it once, God who is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow, he can do it today. I believe that God can strengthen every one of us so that we don't break down in our old age, but we can remain strong. And I believe that some of us, if we're weakened right now, it's because we didn't have all the knowledge we have now. But we have that knowledge now, and we're going to apply that knowledge now with an expectation. An expectation that I don't have to wither away. An expectation that Alzheimer's is not going to bother me. With an expectation that arthritis is not going to break me down. An expectation that I'm not going to deteriorate. I'm not going to waste away. My focus will be fully committed on serving the Lord. And I'll be able to stand. Because he said that if I build my house on the word of God, and this is the word of God, he said the rains will come, the storms will come, and the wind will beat against that house. But that house will not fall. And I say that house is your living body. You are the temple of God. And I say if you build it fully committed on the Lord, God will strengthen you every day of your life. And you'll not have to worry about what rains come, what winds may beat against that house. You can be confident that God is going to sustain you. He's going to keep you up. That's what the word of God says. Yes. Isn't that what the word of God says? Read it for yourself. You must incorporate this into your very being. The words I'm giving you are to protect you. My words are health, says the Lord. My words are not idle words. They are your life. Do you not understand the words I've been giving you? Now, hold fast to the word. Be fully committed to him. Now, I'm not just giving words. I'm going to tell you how to do all of this. I'm going to tell you exactly what you need to do. He says he's looking for somebody. He's ranging eyes. It's like as if he's just scanning. You know why he's scanning? Because there's a bunch of folk that don't really care about being committed to him. He's trying to find somebody. Just like the devil is prowling around looking for whom he can devour. The devil can't get everybody. He cannot get you. I command that in the name of Jesus. He cannot get you. And God is looking for somebody. The devil's looking for somebody. But when God comes across Guiding Light Church, when he comes to Birmingham, Alabama, and he finds this little section of Jefferson County, he'll find within this place people that are fully committed to him. Amen. You wouldn't be up in here if you didn't have some commitment, but I'm here to take you to the next level of a full commitment to God because I need your strength to equal your days. Oh, I may be selfish in what I'm doing right here because I don't want to hurt no more. I don't want to be at home praying, Lord, why did you do this? I talk to him like that. I don't like what you did. I don't like what you did. I don't like what he did. And I don't want to mess with none of y'all. So I got to protect you. As a shepherd, I'll look out for my flock. Where whoever the force is, whatever comes in, I know and I have to submit to not my will, but his will. But I don't have to like his will when he comes in my house and takes people away from me. So I'm giving you his word of what he said needs to be done so I can protect you against yourself who will do what you want to do for you. So the Lord makes a commitment. He says, he will be committed to those who are fully committed to him. That's the law of sowing and reaping. If you are fully committed to him, whatever you sow to him, he's going to allow you to reap. He's going to sow it into your life. Come on, get this rationale in your mind. If I'm committed to God, God's going to be committed to me. If I honor God, God's going to honor me. Whatever I do for God, God will do for me. You got to get that through your head. Amen. This is quid pro quo. That's what the politicians are doing. They're getting paid to screw you. But God loves you. I'm sorry. There's a passion that's in me that calls an anger within me for what's being done today. If you sow to God, he's going to allow you to reap from him. This is just too important for you to miss. You got to hear me. We got to learn the message of being committed. No, not just being committed. Say it again. Being what committed? Being how committed?
Fully committed.
fully committed. And now let me tell you, I back it up. I don't tell you stuff that I ain't got nothing to stand on. I want you to turn to Matthew 22 and 35, and I want you to look at that scripture. The scripture says when Jesus was teaching people, one of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your, and with all your. I want you to look at how it's clustered here, and I want you to look at the very first thing. Look at this, with all your, whose hearts are fully with all of their heart committed to him. This is the first and greatest commandment. When God says he's looking for people that are committed to him, he's looking for folk who are keeping his first and greatest commandment. Amen. Now, to love him is not a partial love. Notice how it's all lined up with all. And nowhere in that does God say you give him part. He said all. And why are we going after it? Because God said the greatest commandment is to love him with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind. That's the greatest commandment. And he says that if we are committed with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our mind, he says, I will strengthen you all the days of your life. I'm not going to miss nothing. If I miss something, I make a mistake, I'm going to find out what I did wrong. And I'm cleaning up for where I missed this. I don't want this happening. I don't want this. I'm fighting against time. I'm fighting. Maybe you don't care about somebody else, but I do care. Sit up here, and we just did last week with our sisters. 95.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If God didn't give us examples, then I wouldn't be trying. But God has given us examples. 85 over here, Sister Gary, right? 83. That's okay. 85, I've already given you. 2 years to your life right now. And understand, we have the examples that God has seen fit to show us every year, still here.
Amen.
We must begin to trust in the Lord, lean not to our own understanding. Stop letting folk tell you something other than what God said.
Amen.
With all your heart, with all your soul,
yes,
with all your mind, God is not a man that he would lie to us. And if he said he's going to do something, he'll do it. He said, if you are fully committed to me, I will strengthen you. Is that not what the word said? And it's honoring him in the first commandment. Many people have commitments to God, but they're not fully committed. And this is the thing. Many people say they love the Lord, but not enough to commit to him. I've seen people I love that hurt because they don't have enough willpower to honor God by putting him first. Or they'll do everything else they need to do. They'll go out and do things for themselves. They go to the movies. You've seen them. They go to the movies. And when you go to the movies, you're going to be on time for the movie because you don't want to miss the first part. But when it comes down to being committed to God, you stroll up in the worship God anytime you get good and ready. That ain't fully committed. You're going to remember to consistently go to the hairdresser and get your hair did every week. But when it comes down to go to church, you can't get no energy to get up. You ain't fully committed. You might be committed, but you can't get your day strengthened. And you're wondering why your life is withering away. Maybe because God ain't building something in your life. Because you put everything else before him. I got to call it out because I don't want to lose nobody. But God said, I'll strengthen you if you're fully committed. You're fully committed to doing things around the house, fully committed to doing things you want to do, fully committed to going to the club, fully committed to being on time for other stuff. But are you fully committed for Jesus?
My Lord.
Your whole life is at stake up in here. I'm not giving you words that are just idle words. Every word I'm speaking to you is a word that can affect your destiny, your eternal destiny, and your life down here.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
That's what God said. It's not me. All I'm doing is emphasizing it. You remember the parable of the talents? The Bible says that he gave one five, one two, and one one. And if you read the scripture very carefully, it said, immediately the one with the five was committed to serving God. Immediately the one with the two was committed to serving God. But the one with the one said, I'll get to it later. And he went and hid it. You can't put God later. You got to put God first. And the one with the five, God multiplied and said, now come into the place that I prepared for you. With the two, he immediately went and did, and God said, come on into the place. God bless them. I need blessings on y'all in this house. I need you to be fully committed to God. Stop playing this game of church and play honest. No, not play, but give God your best. Why you go to a doctor and can go to a doctor and you can't be faithful in church? Maybe the reason the devil can rob you is because you don't honor God, and now you got to pay doctor bills because you're not honoring God with what God told you to honor him with. Have you ever thought about that? Maybe you spend so much time in the hospital and in the doctor's place because you have not put yourself where God created you to be.
My Lord. Mm-hmm.
Do you hear what I'm trying to tell you here? The way of the transgressor is hard. And there's so many different things that I've learned throughout my life. I wish I could help so many of you all to understand. I follow what the word says. I read that book. I'm a dadgum bookworm. I don't do like y'all do. I ain't got the time. I can't do it. They want me to go to Montgomery on Tuesday. I don't want to go to Montgomery. I don't want to go down there. I want to stay home. I don't want to go nowhere. I ain't going nowhere but Arizona. Montgomery too far to go. But no, I don't want to move outside my shell, but what I am, I study. And I study God's word so that you don't have to spend all your time doing all of that. But when I give it to you, you need to listen to me. Amen. Because I'm trying to get your days to be strengthened, all the days of your life. And I'm telling you what God told me to tell you. Be fully committed to him. Do you hear what I'm saying, folks? Don't hurt me with your departure from here. Oh, I know you're going to go be with the Lord, but I don't want you gone with him yet. I want to fellowship with you some more. Some of y'all still ain't spoke to me. Don't leave here and don't have not spoken to me. Now let's look. If we're fully committed, then he said he's going to strengthen us. I think we need his strength. What y'all say? I think we need his strength to make it through every day. I think we need his strength to make it through every little thing we do. And if God doesn't hold us up, we're not going to be able to stand. I think life is too hard to try to make it by ourselves. I think if we let God do it, he said, my yoke is easy, my burdens are light. Let's walk with the Lord and let him make our pathway straight. It's time we learn what being fully committed to God means. Let's talk about it for a minute. Being fully committed to God is this reason. God wants you to be fully committed to him so that the world may know that he's important to you. The reason why he wants you fully committed is because he wants you to be a witness. Did he not declare to you that I've called you to be my witnesses? And when you are fully committed to God, like many of you all are, you are here this morning. Let me tell you what your witness is. When you got up this morning and you drove your car out your garage or you drove your car off the street, people saw where you were going. They say, this early, they must be going to church. That's a witness to Jesus. You're witnessing even though you didn't go out and tell somebody about Jesus. When they see that car going down the street, when the cars turn into the driveway coming up here at guiding light, that's a witness to the world. People going by on John Rogers might be wondering, what are they going up there for? And they see that you think Jesus is worth your time. That means that there's a God in your life. And God will honor you because you are showing the world that you're committed to him. Your faithful being here every Sunday, every Wednesday is a testimony that God is somebody in your life. He's somebody you pay attention to. He's somebody that you honor, that you put first in your life. And see, this is why God wants you to be fully committed. He wants you to be committed because it's a testimony that he's a good God. Oh, listen. Prince died this week. Was he 57? You know, I can't account for Prince. I ain't got nothing to do with Prince. That doesn't even have an effect on me. What did you say? Well, doesn't that lessen you with the death of one man? Look, I am just learning to care about folk in the city of Birmingham. Prince in Minneapolis. It's too dadgum cold up there in Minneapolis. I don't know nothing about that. I mean, I know y'all probably missed him because you miss his music and whatever. But that don't include me. You're so insensitive, Bishop. I'm learning to be more softer with other folk. But my major thing is y'all. You my house. But I'm here to tell you, I'm trying to give you a word so that you'll hold on to it because I'm trying to hold on to you. I can't speak for Prince. Prince didn't want to hear nothing I had to say. I didn't even try to talk to him. But y'all are under me. I'm trying to talk to you to save my folk. Now, he a young man and all that kind of stuff. I think he's young. I mean, I'm 63, okay? So he a young man to me. But what I'm going to do is take care of my house. And I'm going to focus on the one thing God wants me to focus on. You got to be committed to him and be a witness to him. So when you show up in here, you would make it on time to the Prince concert. You better start making it on time to the church to say that you love the Lord. You can go to concerts. You can go off of them, do all that kind of stuff. You need to be showing God that he's my savior. He's worth my time. It shows how important God is to us. The more the commitment we make to God, the more we show the world how important he is. If something is important in your life, people, we commit ourselves to it. Isn't that right? Yes, right. If you like something or you love something, you commit your time to it. Amen. Do you remember how it was when you used to date? And for those that still dating, you know what it's all about. Beep, 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 beep.
Hey, baby.
What's going on, mama?
I was just thinking about you. I couldn't help but think about you, you know, because I just love you so much. Every day that goes by, you always cross my mind all throughout the day. The wind blowing, I hear your voice. I miss you, baby.
You will find every kind of way to let that person know they are somebody. You will text them just thinking of you. You make a commitment. Be up late at night.
You sleep? I'm not asleep. I was just listening to you breathe.
But you understand what I'm saying. If you love something, you spend time with the something you love. And if you love the Lord, you need to spend some time with it. Because, see, God is not going to be deceived by you loving somebody else more than him. He said, I got to be number one. You shall have no other gods before me. You know how to be committed. You know how to be committed to a team. You let it be Alabama, you let it be Auburn, you let it be your school. You'll stand up and you'll shout. But how committed are you to the Lord who controls the days of your life? You got to be committed to the Lord. If it's your job and it's important to you, you're committed to it. You get up, you show up on that job. But when you come up to show up in church, how committed are you in church? You do what the boss tells you to do, but do you do what God tells you to do in the church? On the job, the boss say, get up and go make copies of this. You go make those copies, you get up. But in the church, they say, pick up some paper off the floor. I ain't picking it up. I ain't no maid. You got to show some commitment to the Lord. If your family's important, then you spend time with your family. You make a commitment to it. If your health is important, many of you work out. You go out to try to take care of your health. You go to the doctor to make sure you eat the right things. You do all of that. You got to be committed. Whatever you what's important to you, you commit yourself time to it. Amen. Some of y'all work out all the time because your health is important. Well, you need to work out in the church because to show that God is important. You've got to be committed to God. God said, I will strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to me. If it's important, you're going to commit time to it. You're going to commit something to it if it's important to you. If it's valuable to you, you make the effort. You make the dadgum effort to do it. And why am I pushing you on this issue? Because God said, if you're fully committed to me, I'm going to strengthen you. You ain't got to be sick. Why you got to be sick? You're sick, you're suffering because you ain't fully committed to God. Amen. You say, well, I'm committed to God. I love God. Where? He said fully. Give me back the scripture up there again so you can see that one more thing up there. 2 Chronicles 16:9. And look at this thing. Notice his word is, why is the word fully up there? It wasn't just committed. Too many folk are committed to God, committed to show up every other Sunday, committed to show up once a month, committed to say, I love Jesus. But God didn't say committed every now and then. God don't want no part-time lover. If you're going to be with God, you got to be with him all the way. Can't back down. You're going to have to be fully committed. Fully committed to him. If serving God is important to us, then what we got to do is commit ourselves to serving him. We got to be fully committed to do it. And when we are committed to coming to church like God tells us to do, God will give us the strength to be able to get up in here. Amen. There have been times sometimes when I'm tired, when I'm weary, and I don't want to do something, and I'm just there. But if I press on, when I show God, I don't want to do this now, but I make the effort somewhere along the way. And you need to get this. I've taught you about the lepers along the way. And what I'm trying to tell you, sometimes the devil will want to keep you in that bed. He'll want to keep you from doing what God told you to do. But if you get up and move, it's along the way that God will give you a fresh anointing to keep going on. Sometimes you want to give up. And if you sit there in your bed, if you sit there and complain, you know what? The devil will hit you again and again and again. And finally, you want to just give up. But by faith, I get up. And by faith, I walk on. And by faith, sometime along the way, I don't know when it comes, the strength comes. And God lifts you up if you're faithful. But my brothers and sisters, know this. I understand you too. Sometimes you don't feel like doing it. But if you start doing it any old way, that's when God steps in there. And you look back and you say, how did I get this far? Like the song, if it had not been for the Lord on my side. And that's what you got to hold on to. You got to have him on your side. You got to have him with you. And the way you do that, you got to be fully committed to him. Fully committed. Keep saying those words. And let me tell you the second reason God wants you committed to him. God wants you to be committed to him so that he can strengthen you to become what he created you to be. You see, you didn't exist into the world because your mama and daddy brought you in here. You were created because God has a purpose for you. You were born at the right time that God wanted you to be born because he has a mission for you. He has given to each one of you a manifestation of his spirit for the common good. God has a purpose for you, God in life. God has a purpose for every one of us. God has prepared a purpose for me. All you see when you see me and everything I told you and what's going to happen for me in the next few years and things you've seen that has already happened, it's because I'm taking a stand to stand for what God would have me to do. That's nothing different about me than from you. God's called you to take a stand where you are for the truth, for justice, for righteousness, to tell people the truth. God has a plan for you. And when you become fully committed to him, he wants you committed because then he's going to propel you. He's going to excel you. He's going to push you to be where he wants you to be. And where he wants you to be is a whole lot better than where you could even imagine yourself to be. God's got plans for you. Plans to give you hope. Plans to give you a future. Plans to do good for you. But what you got to do is be fully committed so he can strengthen you so that when you do get weary, you got the energy to keep going on. Amen. When folk have beat you down, talked about you, complained, when they've threatened you, you still have the strength to go on because God is with you. Amen. If you're fully committed to going his way, then he will strengthen you. Fully committed. He wants you to become what he created you to be. You're committed. You're committed to things. Whatever you are today, my brothers and sisters, is because you committed time to be it. If you're a doctor today, you know why you're a doctor? Because you committed time to study medicine. My daughter-in-law, Whitney, was over there a minute ago. She's over there now. She's going to be an optometrist. You know why she's going to be there? Because she committed time to do it. Spent 3 years in school already, and she ain't through yet. She's committed to being that. She's going to excel at doing that. Amen. Many of you all, if you're school teachers, you're a school teacher because you went to school to learn how to teach. You committed yourself time to do it. Where every one of us is today comes from a commitment of our time. What we committed ourselves to is where we are today. Whatever you've committed yourself to will define you. It'll define your destiny. If you commit yourself to making your marriage work, and your marriage works, it's because you committed yourself to it. Amen. Things just don't happen in this world. If you want to be a musician, you have to commit yourself to playing the keyboard or playing whatever instrument. You got to make a commitment. Whatever it is you want to do, if you're an attorney, it's because you committed time to learn to do this. Whatever you want to be successful in, you got to make a commitment to do it. And let me tell you something. If you're not committed to doing anything, you won't amount to anything.
Oh, yes, sir.
You need to be committed to something. Yes, sir. And let me say something to every dadgum one of y'all. If you ain't committed to nothing now, be committed to God and Jesus Christ. And make that your first commitment of every day of your life. Amen. You might not know what you're going to become. You might not know what tomorrow is, but commit today to Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen. And tomorrow is going to be better for you. Amen. Hear my words. Be fully committed to Christ. And Satan knows these things. Satan does not want you committed to God. You know why he doesn't? Because he doesn't want you to achieve your divine potential. He doesn't want you to become all that you can be. Satan doesn't want you strengthened along the way. Satan wants you to fall down and stay down. He knows that if you're fully committed to God, no matter what he does to you, God's going to come in and pick you up. If you fall down, he's going to lift you up. If Satan knows he comes and he kicks you, God's going to block that kick before it gets you. God will send angels to protect you. You never have to worry about a weapon formed against you if you're committed to God. You never have to worry about the voices that will talk about you. You never have to worry about the enemy that's encamped around you. And when they come to eat of your flesh, God said they will stumble and they'll fall. It doesn't matter how many come against you because God has sent one angel and that one angel will protect you. When you're fully committed to God, you can know he stands with you. And if he's with you, who can be against you? I'm tired of seeing my folk hurt in this church. Wake up and commit yourself to God. It ain't about me. I don't care if you come in here about me. If you can't come to God, and like, go somewhere. But be committed to God. This ain't about me. Yeah, I got a big building. My name's on this kind of stuff. But what's more important is your life. This building one day will be gone. All this stuff will be burned up. I'm not trying to manipulate you. You still don't do nothing for me, and I ain't asking nothing from you.
Yes,
sir. I get my little salary. I don't get nothing extra. Y'all ain't putting nothing extra in there for me. I'm not even looking for that. What I want to do is honor my God. I'm serving him, and I need to take care of you. You are his sheep, and I am a shepherd he has called.
Amen.
And I need to lead you, and I need to guide you, and that's what I'm trying to do. Now, if anybody want to give me something, I'm fine, but that's okay. But I ain't asked for nothing, and you know that. Let me tell you, God will help you to become what he created you to be if you give him something to work with. I've told some people a lot of different times, give God something to work with. Some of y'all ain't giving them squat. And you say, Lord, help me. Lord, do this. But you ain't giving him nothing. Amen. And then how your strength going to come? Because you ain't fully committed. Give him something to work with. If you give him something to work with, he will work with that. Do you remember that when he had 5,000 folk that need to be fed? He taught us that lesson. He said, y'all feed them. Wait a minute, Lord, we can't feed them 5,000 folk. We ain't got enough money to feed them, because they were thinking in the natural. One of his disciples said, there's a boy over here. He got 2 fish, 5 loaves of bread. The rest of the folks said, now. And then he said, but what is this for so many? The Lord said, bring them here. And when you gave it to the Lord, 2 fish, 5 loaves, fed 5,000 people. Now, let me read this to you. Your life might be insignificant right now compared to everything that's happening to you. But when you give yourself to him, just like he could take 2 fish and 5 loaves and feed 5,000, he can take you with just your high school education, just with your college degree. He can take you when folk don't even respect you, because they didn't respect those 2 fish and 5 loaves. But God, when you are in God's hand, he can do awesome, mighty, wonderful works if you just become fully committed to him. Do you hear what I'm saying? Because he'll help you become what he wants you to be. But give him something to work with. If all you got, Lord, I went to church Sunday. I've been going to church every Sunday. Now, Lord, work with me. Give him something. Give him something. Do you hear what I'm saying? If I'm sounding forceful on it, it's because I'm trying to get your day strengthened. God wants to strengthen you because he wants you to be committed to him so he can strengthen you to become what he wants you to be. Now, let's look at something for a minute. If you're fully committed to Jesus, he's got to be first in your life. Now, I'm fixing to show you something. I'm fixing to show you what we're going to apply to make this happen, and I'm going to quit after that. Jesus said to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And that's the thing he said is the first commandment, to put God first. So I want you to understand, the very first thing we got to do is to put Jesus first in our life. To be fully committed, we make a commitment to put him first in our life. Say, I will make Jesus first in my life.
I will make Jesus first in my life.
This must become a commitment for you. My commitment for my life to be strengthened so I don't die at 25. I don't die at 55. I don't die at 75. I don't die at 85. And let God strengthen my life is to make him first in my life. Moses died when he was 120 years old. And if you die at 95, you're still too young to go. Because you got more years in your life than God could have given you. Do you hear me? There are folk that live long around in this world today. But with God's power associated with you, you can live long and continue to have wisdom in your mind to be able to help other folk. Don't tell me God can't do that. That's my God. My God's a good God. He can take care of you. You ain't got to break down along the way. Amen. And if you have been breaking down along the way, then I suggest to you, say to God like Hezekiah did, Lord, I'm going to give my life to you. I've already proven it. And go against the grain. Defy the devil. Tell the Red Sea, part. Tell the walls of Jericho, amen, fall. Tell the lions, shut up. Don't open your mouth. Tell the fire, you can't burn me. Tell the water, you can't overcome me. Tell the heavens that you can't harm me. Tell the caves that they can't block you. Tell the world you can't harm this. I'm fully committed to the Lord. I'm trying to give you something to work on. Some of y'all ain't got nothing because you ain't doing nothing. You sorry little cheap thing, you ain't nothing, and you need to do something to change your life.
All right. Amen.
All right.
And sitting up here thinking, I'm committed to God. You ain't committed. All you do is show up every now and then. And then you expect God to do something good for you. Who do you think? Have you read the book? God ain't Santa Claus. He just don't give stuff to folk that don't do nothing for him. When you know what you're supposed to do, he say, much is expected of you. Don't think you can escape with all the knowledge you have and say, God, just love me. I'm sorry. But your life is at stake. Somebody needs to hit you upside the head. You floating around here thinking, I can do all I want to do. God gonna love me anyway. I ain't got to be faithful to church. I ain't got to tithe. I ain't got to give nothing. Okay, it's your life. But I'm going to beat you upside the head, because if you gone, when you one of the sorry ones and you gone, I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to do your funeral. And I'm going to say they're gone to heaven. And that's probably the case. You're going to heaven, but you ain't going to get much when you get there. I'm trying to make sure that everyone gets rich inheritance. I'm sorry. I'm just being honest right now. I'm telling you the whole truth. Jesus got to be first in your life. And this is what he said. Here's what he says. If anyone comes to me and watch this, does not hate his father, hate his mother, hate his wife, hate his children. That's in Luke 14:26. Get it up there so they can see it. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father, hate his mother, hate his wife, hate his children, hate his brothers, hate his sisters, yes, even hate his own life, he can't be my disciple. You can't put nothing first in Jesus, before Jesus. He's saying you got to be, he got to be more than your husband, more than your wife, more than your kids, more than your own life, more than your car, more than your job. Can't nothing be in front of him. You shall love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. That's what he said. He said in Exodus 20, verse 3, you shall have no other gods before me. That God can't be better than God. That man can't be first more than God. That club can't be first more than God. Can't have nothing first before God. And the reason why he wants to be first place in your life, you got to make him make a commitment. I'm going to make him first in my life. He has to be first because he made you. Right. He knows what you're supposed to be. And further, he loves you. He didn't just make you and throw you out there and say, now get on. God still loves you. And he has a plan for your life. He's going to help you accomplish it. He said he'll strengthen you. He'll build you up. He sent his son to die for you. And he wants you to live for him. If you'll just be fully committed to him, what did God say? If you'll be fully committed, what did he say? I'm going to strengthen you. He's going to strengthen your body. He's going to strengthen your soul. He's going to strengthen you in every area of your life. He'll strengthen you on your job. He'll strengthen you in your home. He'll help strengthen your marriage. Strengthen means to strengthen everything. This is too much for us to lose. Put God first so that he may strengthen you. And I tell you, he's got to be first. Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. I keep repeating that. That's the first and greatest commandment. So let me tell you something. If Jesus is not Lord of all your life, in your life, he is not Lord at all in your life. Hear what I said. If he is not Lord of all in your life, he is not Lord at all in your life. Because he said, why you call me Lord and don't do what I say do? He said, a bunch of folk, he said, you think you're going to get in heaven? No, when you get there, I'm going to say, I never knew you because you didn't do what I told you to do. Jesus can't be almost first. He got to be always first. He can't be almost first no more than you saying, I'm almost pregnant. You either are or you are not. You are either with God or you are not. You are either hot or you are cold. There is no lukewarm in your serving God. You got to be fully committed. And if you're fully committed, he's going to take care of you. He will strengthen you. It's time out for playing church. Stop this silly little game. I'm a Christian and you ain't faithful to him. You got to make Jesus first in your life. Make a commitment. He's going to be first in your life. Let me tell you what we're going to do. Here's what the Lord says this. He says in Psalms 37:4, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will do this. What will he do? If you trust in him, he will make your righteousness shine like the dawn. the justice of your cause like the noonday sun. God says, delight yourself. Verse 4, delight yourself in him. He'll give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way. 5 again. Commit. There's that word. Commit. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him and he will do this. Commit. When you commit to God, fully committed to God, he's going to strengthen you. And he says, verse 6, he'll make your righteousness shine like the dawn. The justice of your cause like the noonday. God's saying, first, put me first. So let me tell you how you're going to make this commitment. You've made a commitment. I'm going to put God first in my life. Now let me tell you how to do this. Here's the first thing you need to do in order to be fully committed to God. First thing, talk to Jesus the first of every day. The beginning of your day. Why the beginning of your day? It's the first. You give him the first of everything. Let me tell you what Proverbs 3:9 says. It says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Notice he says, with the first fruits, put God first in everything. What did Jesus say? Seek ye first my kingdom, and then what? All these other things will be added. You put God first, and everything else is going to come. How are we going to make the commitment? We're going to put him first. What did he say? Love the Lord your God first with all your heart. Love the God, your Lord your God. You should have no other God. He must be first. So the commitment and the way of being fully committed is to put him first in everything. So what's the everything? When I get up in the morning, first thing I need to do is look to the Lord. Don't turn over there and look at your baby. Hey, sunshine. No. Turn to him who is able to turn your sunshine on and say, good morning, Lord. First person you ought to talk to, I don't care if somebody else is in that bed with you, you say to the Lord first, thank you, Jesus. I have awoken to a new morning. And I give you honor and praise for this day. Because you are Lord over this day. Then when you want to turn to the other sunshine, and sunshine, how you doing? But make him first of everything that you do. And you'd understand that other sunshine is, you know what I'm talking about. Yeah. Don't defile that other sunshine, you know. Make sure that's the right other sunshine. First thing you do every day is talk to Jesus. Make a commitment to talk to God. Because let me tell you something. Talk to God in prayer before you talk to anybody else, because it's going to help you keep everything in focus. If you start off the day with Jesus, he'll keep sickness away. Amen. You start off the day with Jesus, he can tell you before the pitfalls come that way. And when you start the day with Jesus, if there's something you need to be concerned about, when the devil come your way, Jesus, if he didn't tell you about it, the first thing by the Holy Spirit didn't tell you, he'll tell you right then, don't worry about that, I got this.
All right.
Because you started the day. This day belongs to you, Lord. Amen. And what I'm going to do is I commit this day to you because I begin with you first. First thing in the morning, speak to Jesus. That's how we're going to become fully committed. We're going to do that. Many people, they don't wake up the right way. They wake up to an alarm. Beep, 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 beep. And so they're alarmed by what's going on. And the rest of their day is an alarm. They are alarmed by stuff that goes on because they woke up and they gave homage to the alarm. What you need to do is undo what the alarm was in the morning. It's like the alarm wakes up and say, oh, my God, you're still alive. No. Turn off the alarm and turn to Jesus and say, Lord, may your shalom be upon me this day. May your peace be upon me. The alarm tried to alarm you, but God will calm you. That's what you got to do. You got to turn to the Lord. Don't let that alarm start your day off. It might wake you up, but grab hold of that alarm and say, Jesus, you are my joy. Jesus, you are my peace. No matter what this day is going to do, I know you're going to be with me. I'm not afraid of what this day may bring. Don't wake up to the alarm. No wonder so many people are stressed out because they wake up on the alarm, and the alarm is what got them going all day. The alarm woke me up. I'm alarmed all day. I'm frazzled all day. Oh, I got to go to work. Oh, God, Jesus. Oh, I'm alarmed. Oh, got to make it to work. I'm alarmed. You need a few moments to calm down and let the peace of God reign in your life. See folk that come to the job and they say, good morning. Good morning. What's wrong with you? The alarm. I was alarmed this morning when I woke up. And you go in and you turn on the television and they tell you everything that's going on. Who got shot last night? Who got killed over on the other side of town? And they coming in your neighborhood this week. You need to watch out. Somebody's car got stolen. Somebody's house got broken in. You wake up to alarm. You only hear alarm, alarm, alarm. Sometimes you need to go to the Word of God and find out that no weapon formed against me is going to prosper. Though the enemy might come around me, he will send an angel guards to protect me. The host of heaven will be there for me. I need to look at these things. I'm talking too fast to you. I'm getting caught up on it. But I'm telling you what you need to do. And let me tell you something else, making God first. He's the first of every day. Make Jesus, second point, make Jesus.